بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين. الحمد لله الذي لا يبلغ مدحته القائلون ولا يحصينا معه الآدون ولا يؤدي حقه المجتهدون الذي لا يدركه بعد الحمم ولا يناله غوث الفتن الذي ليس لصفته حد محدود ولا نات موجود ولا وقت معدود ولا أجل ممدود فترى الخلائق بقدرته ونشر الرياح برحمته اللهم أفصل تسلواتك وسلامة تسليماتك على أفضل التعينات المفاضة من العماء رباني وآخر التنزلات المضافة إلى نوع الإنساني كان الله ولم يكن معه شيء ثاني محصي لعظالم حضرات الخمس بوجوده وكل شيء أحسيناه في إمام المبين الرسول النبي المكي الخرشي المدني التهامي صاحب لواء الحمد ومقام المحمود عبد القاسم محمد الأمين وعلى أخيه وسحره وخليفته من بعده وقائد الغر المحجلين ياس الدين إمام المتقين أمير المؤمنين علي بن أبي طالب وعلى ابنته الطاهرة الحوراء الإنسية الراضية المرضية الشفية يوم الجزاء فاطمة الزهراء سلام الله عليها وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المظلومين ولعنة الله على أعدائهم أجمعين من يومنا هذا إلى قيام يوم الدين الحمد لله الذي جعلنا من المتمسكين بولاية أمير المؤمنين وأئمتهم عليهم السلام سلام.
I begin in the name of Allah, the most beneficent and most merciful. We thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for granting us this tawfiq, especially tonight, the night of Qadr, the night of worship, the night of praying, and the night of the martyrdom of the greatest being that this universe has seen after the Messenger of Allah. We find that Amir al-Mu'mineen, his martyrdom, his assassination occurred in the holy month. And those who are associated with the animosity and hatred of Ahlul Bayt, we find them even now going about assassinating the followers of Ahlul Bayt in the blessed month of Ramadan. This is what we are seeing. So when you see, the criteria is very easy to judge. You should know that these are the enemies of Ahlul Bayt who do not honor the sanctity of Masajid, who do not honor the sanctity and dignity of believers, and kill them in the blessed month of Ramadan. Now very quickly, I have very, very little time. Very quickly, I would like to move forward. I wanted to share one riwayah if I am successful in doing that. But before that, on the topic of taqwa, I had shared with you a hadith from Imam Raza alayhi salam. Al-Iman fawqa al-Islam bidarajatin wa taqwa fawqa al-Iman bidarajatin. وَالْيَخِينَ فَوْخَ التَّقْوَى بِدَرَجَةٍ. That Iman is above Islam. Accepting Islam merely by words does not suffice. Iman is at a higher level. We need to attain Iman, which is faith. But then above faith is taqwa, God-weariness. Faith does not suffice, but you have to attain the station of taqwa. And then the Imam says, a higher station than taqwa itself is yaqeen, certitude, for which Quran is filled with citations even from the prophets, how the prophets wanted to attain itminan. We find Hazrat Ibrahim asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, oh Allah, show me how you raise the dead so that I can have that itminan khalb, I can have that certitude that is needed for me. And here, so the Iman, even after taqwa, there is a level which is of yaqeen. And when we see in Holy Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَعَبُدْ رَبَّكَ حَتَّى يَعْتِيَكَ الْيَقِينَ. Worship your Lord until you attain certitude, until you attain yaqeen. So the limit is not even taqwa, the limit is yaqeen, the limit which the prophets aspire to attain, that limit or those heights. And when somebody attains those heights, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Sajda, verse 24, وَجَعَلْنَا مِنْهُمْ أَئِمَّةً يَحْدُونَ بِأَمْرِنَا لَمَّا صَبَرُوا وَكَانُوا بِآيَاتِنَا يُوقِنُونَ. And among them we appointed imams to guide the people by our command when they had been patient and had attained conviction and yaqeen in our signs. And we find in the history of Islam, after the Messenger of Allah, only one person calling upon and saying, لَوْ كُشِفَ الْغِتَى مَا أَجْدَدْتُ يَخِينَا. If the veils are drawn away from me, my certitude will not be added. Meaning that Amirul Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib is saying that his yaqeen has attained that station that he could see the divine heavens and he could see all reality around him. And even if the veils are drawn, there would not be any addition to his certitude. Be inside Allah Shalom. So these are the Imams. This is the station of Imam. The same Ibrahim, when he was tested by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we find Allah after testing him with words, وَإِذِ ابْتَلَىٰ إِبْرَاهِيمَ رَبَّهُ بِكَلِمَاتٍ فَأَتَمَّهُنَّ قَالَ إِنِّي جَاعِلُكَ لِلنَّاسِ إِمَامًا. After Ibrahim was tested, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had appointed Hazrat Ibrahim to the station of the Imama. That is when he attained the Imama. So we find that the wilaya and the Imama is the crux, is the lubb-e-lubab, is the batin of all our worship, of all our acts of submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because wali or wilaya is the one that brings us closer. In fact, the meaning of wilaya is to bring two things to such an extent that there is no gap remaining between them. Meaning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had descended his beloved beings, Ahl al-Bayt alayhi salatu wasalam, so that humanity can get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But we find, my dear brothers and sisters, that these awliya Allah, these wali of Allah, people who were surrounding them, there was a sense of attraction and repulsion with them. Not everybody liked them. Why? Because they did not promote the cause of shayateen, they promoted the cause of Allah. So therefore we find around them also people, and how history had taken many, many turns. If it is only those who were his loved ones, those who were his mirrored ones, and they were praising him, one would say they are doing it out of their love and their association with them. But we find even those who opposed them, they were also praising them in the courts of enemies. We find Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas praising Amir al-Mu'mineen in the court of Amir al-Sham. When Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas was the person who used to feel he was also worthy to the station of being a Khalifa, because he was amongst the committee of six that the second Khalifa had appointed after him, and Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas did not pay allegiance or bay'ah to Amir al-Mu'mineen. But when Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas was called upon in the court of Sham and was asked to curse Amir al-Mu'mineen, he says, I cannot do that, because what I have heard from the Holy Prophet, if the qualities that Ali ibn Abi Talib had amongst those, even if I had one of them, it would have been best in the world that I could have attained in the life of this world. This is how Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas goes on and praises Amir al-Mu'mineen in the court of Amir al-Sham. Now let me share with you another narration in which I find very, very interesting how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala turns things for those who are working for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is Ihtijaj of Qais bin Sa'd bin Ubadah. Sa'd bin Ubadah was the leader of Ansar, and in Sakhifa, he was, Ansar are the people of Medina, Quraysh are the people of Mecca, and Sa'd bin Ubadah was one of the claimants to the station of Khilafa in Sakhifa Bani Sa'idah. He was one of those persons. And his son, Khais bin Sa'd, is the one who is having this conversation with Amir al-Sham. When Amir al-Sham decides to go for Hajj after declaring himself Khalifa, after the martyrdom of Imam Ali and after the martyrdom of Imam Hassan, he comes into the city of Medina expecting huge numbers to receive him. And when he finds himself only surrounded with Quraysh and Meccan immigrants, Muhajireen, who had come to Medina, he is surrounded by them, but he is not seeing too many of Ansar, too many of the people, original people of Medina. He inquires, what is the reason? Why are people not here? Why are the Medinites or Ansar not here? So the answer, he addresses Khais bin Sa'd and addresses Khais bin Sa'd and says, where are the people? Where are the people? Why aren't your people along with the Muhajireen to welcome me? Because you know that people who come into power for the sake of power are always looking for attention. We find it even now. They try to self-promote themselves. Somehow, it is, you know, they have a business and a means of self-promoting themselves. Whereas those whom Allah tries to raise them, their humility brings them down and Allah praises them. Allah keep praising them. So here, this Amir al-Sham is trying to get the feeling of prevailing over the nation and asks Khais, where is Ansar? And he says, well, the Ansar are poor. And Ansar were made poor because they were sidelined and sidetracked, and they ended up only being the laborers in Medina, and the ruling class became that of Quraysh. And the special favors that started from Bani Umayyah and even before that was trickling down only towards Quraysh and Muhajireen, and the Ansar were being sidelined. So the Khais says, they are poor, they do not have a mount, they could not come out of the city to receive you. So the Amir al-Sham gets upset and he says, well, if that was the case, فَأَيْنَ نَوَاذِحْ, where are those camels that are used by the Ansar to fetch water? Because Ansar are laborers, so they have the state camels. They could have come on the state property to welcome me and to show of strength to me. So here at this point, when Khais hears this, he gets really, really upset that not only Amir al-Sham is showing his pomp and glory, he's also trying to undermine Ansar by saying, you are laborers, you could have come with the state machinery to receive me if that was the case. And here, Khais has already turned into an ardent follower and supporter of Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam. And he could not hold on to what has been said to him. And now he says, well, I'm leaving the Arabic Ibarra because of the shortness of time. Qais says, the mounts were perished. They are gone. On the day of Badr. On the day of Badr, the mounts had perished. And the day of Uhud, the mounts had perished. And all other conflicts that were witnessed by the Prophet of Allah, when we had stricken you and your father for the sake of Islam, until Allah's command prevailed over you, and you, after being hostile to Islam, forcefully accepted Islam. This is what Qais is saying to Amir al-Sham. And when he hears this, he gets very upset. And he tries to justify that our acceptance to Islam has been accepted by Allah. And he says, Allahumma ghafran, Allah's forgiveness is from Allah. So Allah has, as if Allah has forgiven us for what we have done. Forgiveness comes from Allah. Khayf does not stop there, and he says, the Prophet of Allah had informed us of the time that would come in the future in which Ansar will be deprived of resources. Ansar will be cornered. Ansar will be persecuted. And then those who are going to rule will only fill their own treasures in their own coffers. This is how it is going to come. And Rasulullah had informed us of this situation that is bound to come. And then Qais says, you are trying to taunt us for working in the fields and fetching water and supporting the community and working as laborers, and you are from the ruler class. Let me tell you that it was we who were on the day of Badr, and we were mounted on these camels that you are recalling, and confronted you with swords and spears while you were striving to extinguish the flame or the light that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had sent upon earth. And you wanted to uplift or uphold the nahj or the path of shayateen, while we were trying to protect the light that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had sent upon the earth. And then when Amir al-Sham hears this, now he says, so you are saying that you did a favor to us. So now Amir al-Sham is trying to say that Ansar are trying to be in the impression that they have done a great favor to us by helping Islam. And he continues and says, the favor is from Allah and from Quraysh. Now Amir al-Sham is trying to emphasize that the favor that came, with which Islam prevailed, came from Quraysh, who had established Islam. Are you, the people of Ansar, think that you are obliged to, we are obliged to you, while the Prophet of Allah is from Quraysh and is the son of our uncle that you helped? Now Amir al-Sham is making associations with the Prophet of Allah. And now he's saying that you, Ansar, think that you, we should be obliged to you, we should thank you, whereas it is opposite. We are the Quraysh who were the ones who helped the Prophet of Allah, and Islam prevailed through us. Favor is from us that Allah made you Ansar and compelled you and made you follow us. This is what Amir al-Sham is saying. Allah guided you through us. This is what Amir al-Sham is saying. So Amir al-Sham is bragging upon being Quraysh, upon being a relative of Rasulullah. And here, see how an ardent follower of Amir al-Mu'mineen responds. Please recite the salawat. He says, oh Amir al-Sham, you think that, what are you talking about? Allah had appointed the Prophet of Allah as a mercy for the whole mankind, from amongst the men and the jinn, and from the red, black and white, for all nations. Prophet of Allah is mercy and a guide to the whole humanity. Allah chose Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and made his messenger the first one to accept, the first one who accepted the faith of Rasulullah and testified him was the son of his uncle Ali ibn Abi Talib. Where are you coming after Fatih Makkah and trying to take credit? The first one who testified the Prophet of Allah and supported him and accepted Iman was the son of his uncle, Abi Talib. Ali ibn Abi Talib was the first one to accept. And then Abu Talib, now he starts praising Abu Talib. He says, Abu Talib defended the Prophet and did not allow the kuffar and mushrikeen of Quraysh to hurt him, nor to stop him from the propagation of Islam that the Prophet of Allah was doing. And then Khayr starts saying Fazail of Amir al-Mu'mineen to such an extent, he starts quoting the verse of Inzar. Anzir Ashirataka al-Aqrabin, the first verse or one of the first initial verses in which the Prophet of Allah was commanded by Allah to call your family and warn them about Islam. And he recalls the whole incident, Dawat-e-Zul Ashira, in front of Amir al-Sham. And then he declares finally what the Prophet of Allah said, who amongst you are willing to accept my invitation and become my wasi, my khalifa, my vicegerent, and the leader for my ummah and my wali. No, and the Prophet of Allah called this statement thrice and nobody stood up except for Ali ibn Abi Talib. Abu al-Mu'min kept saying, Ana ya Rasulullah, Ana ya Rasulullah, Ana ya Rasulullah. And then Khays says that the Prophet of Allah took Amir al-Mu'mineen under his Aba, and placed his hand upon the head of Amir al-Mu'mineen, and then called Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and said, Oh Allah, fill him with knowledge, understanding, and wisdom. And then turned to Abu Talib, the father of Amir al-Mu'mineen, and said, Oh Abu Talib, from now on, listen and obey to your son. Certainly Allah had appointed him for his prophet to the same station as he had appointed Harun for Musa. I don't have time, my dear brothers and sisters, otherwise I would have expanded on all this word. This shows how Abu Talib was not only obedient to Rasulullah, upon the command of Rasulullah, Abu Talib was also willing to obey his own son. This was the commitment of Abu Talib. If anybody considers Abu Talib, ma'azallah, ma'azallah, kafir, that only shows their animosity for Rasulullah, it only shows their animosity for Islam, it only shows their animosity for Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib. Then Khayf goes and recalls the Prophet of Allah had declared Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib with an Ahd al-Ukhuwat, the covenant of brotherhood that he had made amongst the Muhajir and Ansar. But when it came to Prophet of Allah himself, he took Amir al-Mu'mineen as his brother. Both Amir al-Mu'mineen and Rasulullah came from Mecca, but Amir al-Mu'mineen was taken as his brother. Nobody else was taken as his brother. Khayf goes on and starts praising Amir al-Mu'mineen. Then afterwards he starts praising the brother of Amir al-Mu'mineen, Ja'far ibn Abi Talib, and how Ja'far ibn Abi Talib stood for Islam, and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had and his messenger had praised Ja'far ibn Abi Talib. Then Khays continues and starts praising how the marriage of the daughter of Rasulullah took place, and how Rasulullah commenced the marriage of the daughter of Rasulullah with Amir al-Mu'mineen. And these are all fazail. Even Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas had mentioned these fazail of Amir al-Mu'mineen, which he envied that Amir al-Mu'mineen possessed. And when all of this was going on continuously, he said that finally Safifa of Bani Sa'ida came into existence. Remember, Khays's father was the one who was claiming to become from Ansar's side the Khalifa in the Saqifa ibn Sa'ida. Now Khays is the follower of Amir al-Mu'mineen, and he is saying that you Quraysh came with an argument that was only worthy of Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib to make claims and try to claim Khilafah upon yourselves. This is Qais is saying this. And then the Quraysh came and tried to take away the affairs of the Khilafah only and only to oppress Ansar and to oppress Ahl al-Bayt of Rasulullah. And then Qais says, finally, I swear by my own life in the presence of Allah and his progeny, neither Ansar nor Quraysh nor anyone from Arab or Ajam is worthy of Khilafah except for Ali ibn Abi Talib and his progeny. Salawat. And Amir al-Sham becomes very, very upset and very, very angry, and the conversation goes on. But then finally he orders cursing of Amir al-Mu'mineen from every member. The cursing that took place, this is all official, my dear brothers and sisters. The animosity and the hatred. And this was the hatred with which they were filled. As far as Amir al-Mu'mineen is concerned, on the day of 19th or on the night of 19th, Amir al-Mu'mineen, there is a narration in which Amir al-Mu'mineen sees Rasulullah in his dream. And in his dream, he finds Rasulullah, and the narration says that Amir al-Mu'mineen, while sitting, went into the state of Manam, and he saw Rasulullah, and he said, "O my beloved brother and messenger of Allah, what has caused me after you that I am left with the ummah like this? That they hate me and they transpire against me." And Rasulullah told Amir al-Mu'mineen, "O Ali, pray for them." And I prayed, Imam Ali says, I prayed, "O Allah, replace them with a better ones for me and replace me with a worst one for them." And then Amir al-Mu'mineen goes to the masjid, and when Amir al-Mu'mineen wants to go to the masjid, there is another narration from Hujr bin Adi al-Kindi. He narrates that I saw Ashas ibn Qais, who was another staunch enemy of Amir al-Mu'mineen, reminding and recalling Ibn Muljim in the masjid that you have come for a purpose, ensure you fulfill that purpose before it is too late, before the day breaks in. And Hujr ibn Adi al-Kindi, whose grave, his shrine was desecrated recently in Sham, he runs towards the house of Amir al-Mu'mineen to inform him that they are conspiring against you, O ya Amir al-Mu'mineen. They are planning to kill you, O Amir al-Mu'mineen. But the narration says, by the time Hujr ibn Adi could reach the house of Amir al-Mu'mineen, Amir al-Mu'mineen had left from another way, and he had arrived into the masjid. And when Hujr ibn Adi returns to the masjid, only to find that the assassin had already stricken Amir al-Mu'mineen with the sword, and the winds are gushing, and the skies are in the skies there is this voice being raised that the martyrdom of Amir al-Mu'mineen has already occurred. Ali ka khatl ho chuka aur hidayat ki manare munhadim ho gayi hain aur Ali Amir al-Mu'mineen khatl kar diye gaye hain. Yahan tak ke Amir al-Mu'mineen ko Hasnain samalte hain, تھامتے ہیں, اور اس کے بعد بیت الشرف میں لاتے ہیں, اور بیت الشرف کے حالات آپ سے میں نے پہلے بھی عرض کیے عزیزو کہ اصحاب چاہتے تھے کہ امیر المومنین کے اطراف رہے, لیکن امیر المومنین یہ نہیں چاہتے تھے کہ ان کی آوازیں, ان کے بچوں کی آوازیں, ان کے بیٹیوں کی آوازیں نامحرموں تک پہنچے.
یہاں تک کہ علی کو غش پر غش آتا ہے، 19 کا دن گزر جاتا ہے اور 20 کا دن بھی آ جاتا ہے اور بچے بھی روزہ بھی ہے لیکن فاقہ رہنا چاہتے ہیں، اور امیر المومنین اصرار کرتے ہیں بچوں کھانا تناول فرماؤ بچوں، اور وصیتوں پر وصیتیں کرتے جاتے ہیں ایک کے بعد دیگر، سب کو حسن کے حوالے کرتے ہیں، یہاں تک کہ سب جب حسن کے حوالے ہو جاتے ہیں تو ایک ننا سا بچہ کمرے کے اتاق کے دامن میں گوشے میں گریا کرتا ہے، اور جب گریا کی صدا سنائی دیتی ہے تو وہ ابو الفضل عباس ہے۔ ایک مرتبہ ام البنین سوال کرتی ہے، بیٹا کیا بات ہے، کس وجہ سے تم رو رہے ہو؟ ایک مرتبہ جب سوال کا جواب عباس سے ملتا ہے، اما بابا نے سب کو بھائی حسن کے حوالے کر دیا لیکن مجھے یکو تنہا چھوڑ دیا۔ ایک مرتبہ اب عباس کو لے کر ام البنین آتی ہے، علی کے پاس آتی ہے، آقا آپ سے گزارش ہے کیا میرے بچے نے کوئی خطا کی ہے مولا؟ عباس کو آپ نے کسی کے حوالے نہیں کیا، سب خانوادے کو تمام خاندان کو آپ نے حسن کے حوالے کر دیا۔ ایک مرتبہ علی کے سامنے کربلا کا منظر آ جاتا ہے اور علی گریا فرماتے ہیں اور رونے لگتے ہیں اور کہتے ہیں عباس کو لاؤ اور حسین کو طلب کرتے ہیں، اور ایک مرتبہ عباس کا ہاتھ حسین کے ہاتھ میں بلکہ حسین کا ہاتھ عباس کے ہاتھ میں رکھتے ہیں اور کہتے ہیں عباس سے، عباس خبردار رہنا، یہ رسول کا بیٹا ہے عباس اور تم میرے بیٹے ہو عباس، جب تک تمہارے سینے میں جان باقی ہو عباس حسین پر آج نہیں آنا چاہیے۔ عزیز و عام جانتے ہیں جب تک یہ مایوس سلامت تھے کوئی حسین کی طرف انگلی بھی نہیں اٹھا سکتا تھا، لیکن ہاں عباس کے جانے کے بعد حسین کا نوحہ تھا، عباس تمہارے جانے سے حسین کی کمر ٹوٹ گئی، عباس دشمن جرت کر رہے ہیں عباس۔ وہ وقت بھی آتا ہے کہ ایک مرتبہ ہاتف غیبی سے صدا آتی ہے، امیر المومنین اس دنیا سے رحلت فرما چکے، وہ وقت بھی آتا ہے حجب وصیت امیر المومنین نے جیسے کہا تھا ویسے ہی حسنین امیر المومنین کو لے جاتے ہیں دفن کرنے کے لیے۔ ایک آمادہ خبر ملتی ہے جہاں پر امیر المومنین کو قبر میں رکھا جاتا ہے، اور قبر میں رکھنے کے بعد جب امیر المومنین کو کوفے سے باہر جو آج نجف اشرف ہے وہاں پر امیر المومنین کو دفن کیا جاتا ہے، ایک مرتبہ حسنین وہاں سے واپس ہوتے رہتے ہیں کہ ایک مرتبہ ایک صدا آتی ہے حسنین کی آوازوں کو سن کر، امام حسن کی آواز کو سن کر، ایک مرتبہ ایک غریب آواز دیتا ہے، ایک فقیر آواز دیتا ہے، ایک نابینا آواز دیتا ہے، اے آنے والے تو نے اتنی تاخیر کر دی، تجھے پتا ہے تیرے سوا میرا کوئی بھی اس دنیا میں نہیں ہے، جب تو آتا ہے تو تیرے آنے سے میرے زخم صاف ہوتے ہیں، جب تو آتا ہے تو تو ہی ہے جو مجھے کھلاتا ہے نہلاتا ہے میری خدمت کرتا ہے، اب 3 دن گزر گئے اور تو نہیں آیا، تجھے پتا ہے اس حالت میں میں زندہ نہیں رہ سکتا، ایک مرتبہ گلا کر رہا ہے، اور ایک مرتبہ حسن روتے ہوئے اس کے قریب آتے ہیں، کیا دیکھتے ہیں، ایک جزامی فقیر نابینا بہت سن رسیدہ جنگل میں پڑا ہوا ہے، کوئی اس کا پوچھنے والا کوئی اس کا یار یا غمخوار نہیں ہے، اور وہ کہتے ہیں، امام فرماتے ہیں تو کس سے مراد ہے تیری؟ تو کس کو صدا دے رہا ہے؟ ایک مرتبہ سننے والا کہتا ہے فقیر نابینا جزامی کہتا ہے یہ کیا بات ہو گئی کہ تین دن کے نہیں گزرے تو اب مجھے پہچانتا بھی نہیں، تیری ہی وجہ سے میں تو آج زندہ ہوں، تو مجھے آتا تھا میری خدمت کرتا تھا، میں اسی سے تو باقی ہوں، میں اسی سے تو زندہ ہوں۔ امام سمجھ جاتے ہیں اور ایک مرتبہ امام رونے لگتے ہیں، اور جب وہ سبب پوچھتا ہے تو امام فرماتے ہیں تجھے نہیں معلوم وہ خلیفۃ المسلمین تھا جو تیری خدمت میں آتا تھا، وہ مسلمانوں کا حاکم تھا جو تیرے زخم صاف کرتا تھا، تجھے نہلاتا تھا، تیری نظافت کرتا تھا، وہ میرا بابا تھا، وہ رسول کا وصی تھا، وہ علی ابن ابی طالب تھا۔ جیسے ہی علی ابن ابی طالب کا نام سنتا ہے بہت گریہ کرتا ہے، بہت گریہ کرتا ہے، اور یہاں تک بھی ہے کہ کہا گیا ہے کہ بہت التماس کرتا ہے مجھے علی کی خبر پر لے چلو، اور وہیں پر اپنا سر رکھ کر اس دنیا سے گزر جاتا ہے۔ علی جو کیسا علی تھا، کیسا ہمارا مولا تھا کہ وہ لوگ جس کو کوئی نہیں پوچھتے ان کو بھی پوچھتا علی، یتیموں کا پرور بھی علی، یتیم پرور بھی علی، غریبوں کی نگہداری بھی علی، اسلام کی حفاظت بھی علی، اور مسلمانوں کی حفاظت بھی علی، دین کی حفاظت بھی علی۔ لیکن علی کی آنکھ بند ہوتی ہے، زیادہ وقفہ نہیں گزرتا، بنی امیہ کی دشمنی کربلا میں یہاں تک بڑھ جاتی ہے، اور جب حسین سوال کرتے ہیں اگر تم کیا چاہتے ہو، کیا میں نے شریعت محمدی کو بدلا ہے؟ کہتے ہیں نہیں۔ پھر کیا چاہتے ہو؟ تم نہیں جانتے میں رسول کا نواسا ہوں، میں فاطمہ کا بیٹا ہوں؟ کہتے ہیں ہم جانتے ہیں، یہ بغض ابھی تمہارے بابا کے بغض میں ہم تمہارا قتل کرنا چاہتے ہیں۔ یہاں تک کہ حسین کا قتل شام غریبہ آ جاتی ہے، حسین شہید ہو جاتے ہیں، لیکن وہ جو یتیم پرور تھا ان کے بچے جب یتیم ہوئے ہیں تو کربلا میں خیام میں آگ لگا دی گئی، اور ان کے دامن میں آگ لگائی، ان کے تماچے لگائے گئے، اور ان کو دیار بدیار پھرایا گیا۔
صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم ایام القلب القلب انا لله و انا الیہ راجعون۔ بار اللہ تسلیم قلنا و بارک و قبول فرمائے، ہمیں کوئی غم نہ سوائے غم سید الشہداء کی۔ جملہ مومنین و مومنات کے حاجات کو برلا، جو مقروض ہیں ان کے قرضوں کو ادا فرما، جو بیمار ہے باقی بیمار کربلا شفا عنایت فرما، تعجیل فرما ظہور قائم آل محمد، ہم سب کو ان کے ناصر و شمار۔ ناتم حسین۔